Good afternoon, friends. In my previous lecture on labor accounting and control, we were discussing different aspects of labor accounting. We talked about direct labor, indirect labor, how we account the different aspects of the labor, and we talked about labor turnover. So, in continuation of that, I am discussing in the beginning different aspects of labor accounting, and then we will switch over to the how we make the timekeeping in accounting, how we do deal with the different aspects of the labor. So, to start with, let us discuss about the overtime. What you mean by overtime? Each worker in a factory is expected to work in certain working number of working hours, that is called normal working hours. If that workers works beyond that working hours, that is called overtime. See, in India, all factory workers are being covered under Factories Act, and as per the Factories Act, a worker is expected to work maximally 9 hours in a particular day or 48 hours in a week. That is, in the whole of the week, maximally he is expected to work for 48 hours, or in a particular day he is expected to work maximally 9 hours. So, right, if that person, that worker works beyond that working hours, he or she is entitled for overtime. Means overtime is that time for which, I mean, if a worker works for more than normal working hours, he or she is entitled for overtime. So, the Factories Act provides for payment of overtime wage at double the normal rate of wages. That is, if a person is getting 100 rupees per hour, and if that person works beyond that working of normal working hours, he is expected to get, or she is expected to get, at the double the rate of the 100, that is 200 rupees per hour. So, basically, when we talk of the overtime, overtime is not a very good practice in any of the organization, because if we indulge, or if the factory resort to the overtime to the workers, then it will lead to increase in labor cost. Because why it increase to labor cost? Because that person will have to pay more than the normal rate. He will have to pay, or she will have to pay, the double the rate of the normal hours. It put an extra strain on the plant and machinery. Means there are certain number of working hours which the plant is expected to work. If the machinery works more than that, there is a more chances of breakdown. There is a more chances of, problems in the machine. So, machine has also a nerve, so it puts an extra strain on the working hours. Similarly, during overtime hours, labor productivity is decreased because of diminishing labor efficiency. We presume that a person, if he works up to a particular number of hours, his or her efficiency remains at a particular level. And if he works beyond that working hours, there are chances. I am not saying it is necessary, but there are chances that because of the fatigue, because of the tiredness, the efficiency may be affected. So, it also leads to the labor diminishing labor efficiency. Bad effect on the health of the worker, because if he works beyond a number of working hours, because the minimum number of rest hours are also required for each of the individual. If he works beyond a number of work hours, it may gradually affect his or her health. Certain overheads like lighting cost increases because of work in the evening. If you are working in the late evenings or the evenings, the more lighting, more air conditioner and all these things will be required. And workers may develop, there is another disadvantage of it, workers may develop a tendency to work in overtime and take overtime wages as a part of their normal working hours. Because as we have just discussed, that in the overtime, a worker is being paid double the rate of the normal working hours. So, he knows it, or she knows it, that if he works beyond the normal working hours, he will be paid extra, and that part of the extra work, the extra hours which he put in the organization, right, he presume that this is part of my salary, I should get this much. Because in the normal working hours, he may not, or she may not work as per the best of his efficiency, and he tends to delay the work so that he or she becomes entitled for overtime. So, there may be a tendency, there may be, I am not saying it is always a necessity, but it may lead to the delay in the work, and the worker tends to work in the extra working hours or the overtime hours. Like, for example, how do you calculate the wages for overtime? I am presuming here that a worker works for 8 hours on Monday, 10 hours on Tuesday, 9 hours on Wednesday, 11 hours on Thursday, 9 hours on Friday, and 6 hours on Saturday. So, what you find here is, and normal idle time as I said, normal overtime as I said, that if a person works beyond 9 hours, he or she is entitled for overtime, and in a week beyond 48 hours, the worker is entitled for the overtime. So, the normal working hours are 8 hours a day, and the normal rate is presumably in this example 100 rupees per hour. So, overtime rate is, as per the in this organization, up to 9 hours in a day, normal rate will be paid, and over 9 hours in a day, double the rate will be paid, or up to 40 hours per week, normal rate, and over 48 hours, the double the rate, whichever is more beneficial to the workers, right. So, in this example which we have taken, in this example what you find is that the total number of working hours which the worker is putting in the factory is 52 hours, 53 hours. So, total hours, if you add up the working hours of all the 6 days, that is from Monday to Saturday, it comes to be 53 hours. And how do you calculate wages? The first criteria is up to 9 hours, normal rate, and beyond 9 hours in a particular day, right, he will be paid or she will be paid double the rate. So, in this hour, there are total working hours are 53. For 50 hours, because from Monday to Saturday, on 2 days, he is working more than 2 hours. So, for 50 hours, 100 rupees, that comes to be 5000, and for 3 hours, like that is in case of the Tuesday and in case of Thursday. Tuesday, that person worked for 10 hours, and on Thursday, that person works for 11 hours. So, for Tuesday, 1 hour, he is entitled for overtime, and on Thursday, he is entitled for 2 hours. So, as per the first criteria, 9 hours in a day up to normal rate and beyond 9 hours overtime. So, for 50 hours at the rate of 100, that comes to be 5000. For 3 hours, that is on for Tuesday and Thursday, for 3 hours he is entitled for 200 rupees extra. So, the total comes to be, the total weekly salary of that person comes to be 5600. But in this example which we have taken, the second criteria is that up to 48 hours per week, normal rate, and beyond 48 hours, double rate, whichever is beneficial to the worker. So, in this case, for 48 hours at the rate of rupees 100, and beyond 48 hours, that is he works for 53 hours, for 5 hours at the rate of 200, it comes to be 1000. So, the total weekly salary is 5800 as per this criteria. So, worker will be paid 5800, which is higher, because as I say, whichever is higher, whichever is more beneficial to the worker, that wages will be paid. So, in this way, what you find is for 53 hours, instead of paying 5300 rupees, if the normal rate is being paid, worker would have been entitled for 5300 rupees. But since the worker is working overtime for 5 hours, or he or she is extra entitled for the double the rate, so its salary comes to be 5800. So, this is the way we calculate overtime. So, what you find is that when a person works overtime, he is being paid or she is being paid an extra amount. So, how do you treat? Now, the question is, how do we treat overtime in cost accounting? Payment of overtime consists of two elements. One is normal amount of wages, and the other is additional amount paid for overtime work. We call it overtime premium. As in the example we have just discussed, the normal rate is 100, but for overtime the rate is 200 per hour. This 100 rupees extra per hour which the worker is being paid, that is called overtime premium. So, as far as the normal time is concerned, that is the normal amount is concerned, if a worker is working, at the normal rate, so 100 rupees per hour, this 100 rupees per hour will be charged to the production cost, means the normal amount is charged to the cost unit or production order on which the worker is working. And as far as the overtime premium is concerned, means for which he is being paid extra, the difficulty lies in the treatment of overtime premium. So, overtime premium is charged differently under different circumstances as stated, right? Means I will be discussing how you will treat this extra payment, that is overtime premium. As far as the normal idle time is concerned, normal time is concerned, that will be paid, charged directly to the cost unit produced. But the extra premium that is being paid to him, which we call it overtime premium, how we treat it in the cost accounting, this is a problem and depends on the case to case we treat it. Like charge to job as direct cost. One way is we charge to the job or whatever we are producing it, we charge directly to that production unit or production processes that we are charging the labor cost. When overtime is worked at the request of the customer due to urgency of work, entire charge of the overtime is being charged from that work itself or that units produced itself. That is, suppose a customer comes to you and he gives a rush order to you that he said, okay, at any cost I want this product to be supplied within a week. And you said very categorically that it is very difficult for us to produce this in normal time. He said, okay, I will give you some extra for the money which you will pay extra to the workers. In that case, the amount will be charged directly to the units produced or that to that process or to that job. So, it will be charged as a direct cost. Charge to overhead. When overtime is payable due to general pressure of work or seasonal nature of production, it should be charged as overhead. Suppose there is a normally in the business in our work, there is a general pressure of work and by and large we find that overtime is being paid to the workers within the normal working hours. It is not possible for the workers to produce that much production. So, in that case, this extra amount of premium that is because of the extra pressure of work or suppose of the seasonal nature of the work or because of the festival like Diwali has just gone. In Diwali's days, there is a normal order, extra orders which you have to supply. So, on those 2-3 months, you are getting the works more number of hours from the worker. So, if that is from the general nature of the pressure of the work, that should be charged as a overhead, means you should charge to the production overhead. You should not charge directly to the units produced, direct cost, but you should charge as a production overhead. And there are certain situations which I will be just dealing with in which you charge overhead premium to the costing profit and loss account. Normally, when the overtime is being paid because of abnormal reasons or because of our faulty planning, or because of some abnormal reasons, in that case, we charge the overtime premium to the costing profit and loss account. Overtime required due to abnormal factors, what can be the abnormal? Like suppose there is a natural calamity, there can be flood, fire, earthquake, etc. Due to factors like defective planning or faulty management, it should not be charged to the cost, but charged to the costing profit and loss account. When I say charge to the costing profit and loss account, what does that mean? Means it should be showed separately as an abnormal cost and charged in the profit and loss account directly. So, if the overtime premium is being paid because of abnormal reasons, in that case, you will charge overhead premium to the costing profit and loss account. So, now as we have discussed that due to overtime, the cost goes up, there is a overtime premium that you have to pay. So, the overtime should be controlled. Overtime cost should be duly authorized by work managers. Means how we control it? That whenever an employee has to work for extra number of working hours due to more than normal hours, it must be authorized by some senior officer or the production manager, by the works manager or the production manager. For proper planning, overtime cost should be separately recorded in each of the department. Means the normal payment, normal wages which you pay, that should be showed separately, and the overtime premium which you pay, that should be shown separately. So that the idea is, so that the departmental head or the cost accountant or the works manager can know immediately how much is the extra cost that the organization is bearing due to overtime. Regular reporting to total overtime premium should be made to the works manager. Means, as we discussed in this previous point, that it should be shown separately, but it should also be reported to the production manager or some senior manager level, so that it can be idea is to control the overtime premium. When overtime becomes a permanent feature, say due to shortage of plant capacity, steps may be taken to install additional plant and machinery or introduce additional shift to cope with the additional work. Because the cost of the production goes up due to overtime premium, and suppose there is a shortage of plant capacity, so either you install a new plant or you can think of additional shift. Suppose at present the workers are working in one shift in a day, so then you can think of even second shift if that is the, I mean, double the amount of the work is there. So if you feel that if we have the second, we will make cost benefit analysis that if the second shift is being made, more number of workers, the other workers, new workers are being called for the second shift. So you can find out what will be the cost of that, and by making cost benefit analysis you can think of this additional cost involved in it. So this is how you deal with the overtime. So what we have discussed in the overtime is what is overtime, what are the implications of the overtime, how you deal in the cost accounting the overtime, and this overtime cost should be controlled. As I said earlier, the in cost accounting point of view, we as a cost accountant, we must see that how to deal, how to account for this overtime. As I said, if the overtime is due to basically normal pressure of the work, right, we can charge the production overheads, or if it is because of the extra pressure of the work, or it is because of the abnormal nature of the work, we should charge to the costing profit and loss account, and the overtime should be, overtime premium especially should be properly controlled so that there is a check on the overtime. So friends, after talking of overtime, now let me talk of another aspect of the cost accounting in the labor issues of the cost accounting, idle time. Says what is this idle time? Idle time, I would say, is the difference between the work the number of hours for which a worker is being paid and the number of hours which he or she is involved in productive activity or production. So idle time is the difference, it represents is the time which workers are paid but no production is obtained, or put it this way, it is the difference between the time which the worker is involved in the production and the time for which the worker is being paid. The difference of the two is called idle time. Suppose in a day, if I works for 8 hours a day, means the moment I enter into the factory, my time is being recorded, and when I leave the factory, my time is being recorded, and this time comes to be 8 hours. And on an average, I works for 7 hours a day, that is 1 hour I am not directly involved in the productive activity or production. So this 1 hour is called idle time. So example, time lost between factory gate and department, means at the factory the clock is installed, the attendance system is being installed, you record the time when you enter into the factory, right? But if there is a large size of factory, it takes 10 minutes, 15 minutes to reach your department, right? So this 15 minutes, which I am not saying it is abnormal, but it is time which bound to take place, but for this 15 minutes I am not involved in any productive activity, right? So this is called idle time. Time when production is interrupted by machine maintenance, tea breaks, your personal needs, sometime you have some personal needs, for that personal need means like washroom, you have to go to the washroom, right? Lunch breaks, tea breaks, so this is all called idle time. So idle time may occur due to three important reasons. One is called productive causes, other is called administrative causes, and third is called economic causes. That is, overtime may occur because of productive reasons, administrative reasons, and economic reasons. Now let us discuss one by one. What do you mean by productive causes? Like when you are in the production process, a worker is working, suppose there is a sudden breakdown of machine, right? So when the breakdown of the machine, the worker will not able to work for that period of time where the machine remain breakdown till the time the problem is being rectified. So that time the worker remain idle, means there is a separate maintenance department. Maintenance department will maintain the machine and rectify the error, rectify the problem. For that time the worker will remain idle. So this is basically productive reason. Power failure, if you have don't have your own power generator and suddenly there is a power failure for 1 hour, 2 hours, for that worker is available for work but he or she is not directly involved in the production process. So that will becomes the idle time. Waiting for tools and a raw material, tool is not ready, or sometime when the even tools are available, you have to rectify it, you have to maintain the tools, right? Setting up time is being taken. Sometime you are waiting for the raw material, you are ready for the work, but the raw material is not available, the store is sending the raw material. For that time, the rabble remain idle. So, this is productive reasons. Waiting for instructions. The person is ready for work, but the foreman or the supervisor has not passed on the instruction what has to be done. So, for this time, the worker remains idle. So, these are all the reasons of the productive causes of the idle time. That is machine breakdown, power failure, waiting for tools and raw materials, waiting for instruction. This list is not exhaustive, but broadly these are the reasons of productive reasons of productive causes of idle time. The other can be the administrative causes. That is, idle time may take place because of administrative reason. Caused by administrative decisions, like decisions of not to utilize the surplus capacity during the depression. Means you have a capacity in your plant. Your plant can produce, your worker can produce for in X number of units, but because of the slowdown, you are not making full utilization of the plant. So, the worker will remain partly idle. Such idle time arises out of abnormal situations and is generally not controllable. So, sometime because of abnormal reasons, like there is a flood. So, the worker is there because of the flood, the machinery and all these things, you are not in a position to work. So, these are all abnormal reasons which are uncontrollable. There are economic reasons also, economic causes also for the idle time, like caused by fall in demand of product, say due to severe competition, seasonal nature of certain industries, like for example, woolen industry, ice cream industry, right. So, these are of seasonal nature. In a particular season, like in the woolen, the winters, there is a more demand, but in summers, there is a less demand, right. In the ice cream industry, although the demand of the ice cream remains throughout the year, all of you students are always interested in having the ice cream, but in summers, the sale of or the production of the ice cream is more. And because of the nature of the production of the ice cream, you cannot preserve it for a very long period of time. So, by and large, in the summers, that is more, the sale is high. In the winters, the sale is low, so that the worker will remain idle. And then some workers are of technical nature, some people are skilled workers. You can't, means the management don't want to retrench them. So, for that period, a worker will not able to work according to his or her full capacity. So, he will remain idle, right. So, in these type of, these are called economic causes. In such cases, it is not possible to get rid of workers during the slack seasons. So, there are three causes which we have discussed: productive, administrative and economic causes. So, these are reasons of idle time. Now, the question is, how do we deal idle time? Means, how we treat idle time in the cost accounting point of view. Now, I will again segregate idle time into two categories. That is normal idle time and abnormal idle time. So, normal idle time, what is it normal item? That wastage of labor time which cannot be avoided and has to be borne by the employer. That is, these are the idle time that bound to arise. When I was just talking of the idle time, I said when a worker enters into the factory and reaches the department, it takes 10-15 minutes to reach the department if the size of the factory is large, if the factory is of large size. So, this you cannot avoid it, you can only minimize it, you cannot avoid it. This type of idle time is bound to take place, right. There are certain personal needs, right. He or she has to go at least once or twice in this 8-hour working hours to the washroom, right. So, this is normal, very normal. So, examples are time which elapses between the completion of one job and the commencement of the next, personal needs which I have just referred, time spent in setting the machines, etc. So, this is normal item treated in one of the following two ways. Now, the question is, how do we treat normal idle time? There are two methods by which the idle time can be treated. One is, it can be charged to factory overhead, and the other is, wage rate is inflated so as to make allowance for normal loss of labor time. So, there are two ways of treating idle time. Either you charge it as a factory overhead, or you inflate the per hour or per week, whatever the way we calculate, per hour rate of the wages. So, these are the two methods of the treatment of normal idle time. We are discussing the treatment of overtime. As I just said, the normal idle time can be treated in two ways, either charge to the factory overhead or inflate the per hour working hours, per hour rate. So, for example, suppose if a worker works for 8 hours, the time recorded is he is being paid or the worker is being paid for 8 hours and the per hour rate is 100 rupees, right? So, he is being paid 800 rupees per day, but actual production time is 7 hours. So, 1 hour is idle, which is normal, which includes lunch break, tea breaks, I mean personal needs and all those changing from one job to another job or any which is normal. 1 hour we presume it is a normal. So, what we will do is that per hourly rate will be treated as not 100 rupees, but 800 divided by 7, that comes to be 114 something, right. So, at this rate, if a worker works for 3 hours on a particular job, so the worker will be charged or the product will be charged not at the rate of rupees 300, but at the inflated rate, that is 114 and odd figure, so multiplied by 3. So, at that rate that job will be charged. We call it inflate the wage per hourly rate of the worker. So, this way you treat the normal idle time. And how we treat abnormal idle time? What is abnormal time? Which is beyond normal, which is because of abnormal reasons, because of faulty planning, or I mean these are the reasons, because of natural reasons if any idle time takes place. So, this abnormal idle time arises due to reasons in no way connected with the usual routine of manufacturing and for which employer must pay, right. So, example strikes, lockouts, time lost due to breakdown of machinery, accident, etc. This is called abnormal idle time. So, this abnormal idle time may also attribute to defective planning, inefficiency or bad luck. Payment for such idle time is not included in cost and is being charged to the costing profit and loss account. This last part is very important. So, this abnormal idle time which is taking place because of defective planning, because of abnormal reasons, because of inefficiency, because of we just talked about strikes, lockouts, right. So, these how do you treat it? It should be charged separately to the costing profit and loss account. Means the moment I say charge separately the costing profit and loss account, means it should be shown as a separate cost, it should be shown as a loss. So, normal idle time you charge to the production overhead, right, or the cost produced, or you charge at an inflated rate, right. And as far as the abnormal idle time is concerned, you charge to the profit and loss account, that is costing profit and loss account. So, idle time must be controlled. You say that idle time should remain minimum. We must try to minimize. You as a works manager, your duty is, and you as a cost accountant, your duty is to minimize the idle time. So, the question is how do we control idle time? By proper planning of production to reduce or to avoid imbalances. Means the imbalances in the production, sometime there is a more production, for that time you have to pay overtime, but sometime there is a less production, for that during those days there is a less production, your plant remain idle, your workers remain idle and you have to bear the idle time cost. So, there must be a proper planning of the production. Regular repairs and maintenance of plant and machinery to avoid breakdown. At the time of saying reasons, talking of the reasons of the idle time, said sometime there is a breakdown of the machine, so worker remain idle. So, if there is a proper regular maintenance of the plant and machinery, the breakdown will be minimized. So, we should try to minimize the breakdown of the machinery. No time wasted in waiting for raw material, tools and instructions of the worker. If we make proper planning, right, in advance. So, at no point of time worker will remain idle for waiting of the material or waiting for the tools or waiting for the instruction. So, the proper planning should be made so that the worker time is not being wasted for lack of the material or lack of tools or waiting for the instruction, right. And there must be a proper supervision so that no worker remain idle during the working hours. So, this is about treatment of the idle time, right. And after talking of overtime, idle time. Now, let's very briefly discuss about fringe benefit. Fringe benefits means the benefits which are being paid extra to the employed. See, apart from the salary, basic pay and the dearness allowance which every employee is entitled or which employee is being paid, you are being paid, say for example, holiday pay. You remain, you go for a week holiday and the employee will pay you retirement benefits, right? Medical benefits, children education allowances, right? These are the various fringe benefits which employer pays to the employees. These are called fringe benefits. So, benefit given to the worker in addition to the basic wage and dearness allowance is called fringe benefits, like medical facilities, canteen benefits, means at in the canteen your food is at very subsidized rate, like you are getting food at 10 rupees per thali or per meal, right? So, which cost to the firm is 40 rupees or 50 rupees, but you are serving to the employees at the rupees 10. So, this is fringe benefit, sick pay, right? Holiday pay, leave pay, pension and other retirement benefits, these are all called fringe benefits. These benefits are not related to the quantity of work done, means it is not related to the quantity. Each employee is being given the these fringe benefits. So, cost of such benefits should be treated as a production overhead which are allocated to the various departments, means will allocate it to the various department either on the basis of number of employees or on the basis of wages paid to the workers in each of the department. So, this we will discuss in detail while we'll be talking of the overheads in the cost accounting. So, this is the way you treat the fringe benefits, that is you charge it as a production overhead and which are being allocated or apportioned to the various departments. So, after talking of these different issues, now let us discuss a very important issue of this labor accounting is timekeeping. Timekeeping means keeping a record of the time that the worker is devoted on the work or in the factory. So, timekeeping means recording time for attendance purpose and for calculation of wages. See, especially in a large organization, there is always a challenge to keep track of the employees. There are thousands of employees who are working in the organization. So, you have to keep a proper record how many hours or the employee has worked in the organization, in the factory, or when he or she is on leave and how many number of working days he or she has reported for the work. So, you have to keep a proper record of each and every employee who works in the organization. So, the time of the record timekeeping department is to have proper attendance and so that the wages can be properly calculated. The other important aspects of the timekeeping is that time booking, means record time spent on different jobs or processes for determining labor cost or job. Means I am in the factory, I am available, I am in the organization, but within my time, within my 8 hours which I spend in my factory, I may be spending different number of working hours on different jobs or different processes. So, or on each of the job or in on each of the process or on each of the work, how many number of hours I have put in, that also have to be recorded properly so that the job can be charged proper labor cost. That we call it, the term we use it, time booking. So, there are two important aspects, time keeping and time booking. So, how do you have a record of the time keeping? How do you have a record of the attendance of the worker? I'll just quickly talk of these because these are all traditional methods, right? One is called attendance register, which almost all of us are familiar with, that there is an attendance register in each of the organization, especially in the small organization. This attendance register system is not very much suitable in a very large organization with thousands of workers work. But in a small organization, SMEs, we call it small and medium enterprises, where 5 workers, 7 workers, 10 hours, 10 workers work. So, we have a attendance register. In this method, attendance of each worker is recorded in the register maintained for this purpose. So, this register provides sufficient number of columns for attendance of each of the worker. Entries in the arrival and the departure column may be made by the worker himself or herself. This method can be used only when the number of worker is small. As I said in the beginning, in a small organization, normally this attendance system is, or the time attendance register system is being maintained, that a register is being put right in the office or in the factory, right? Each worker who reports for the work, he records the in time and the out time while coming in the factory or coming in the organization, he or she records that time, and while going out of the factory, going out of the organization, he records that time, so that the attendance is being maintained each day when he or she enters, the time is being recorded, and when she leaves, the time is being recorded, and so that on day basis on one, and for each month, we have a register that how many number of days the person has worked and how many hours the person has worked. So, this is basically a attendance register system. This is a traditional method. Another traditional method is token or disk method. Each worker is allotted an identification number, that is a number is there for a worker, and that number is suitably painted or engraved on a round metal token with a hole in it. Means there is a round metal, right, and token, and there is a hole in it. So, each worker is being allotted an identification number or number, like there are 500 employees. So, each worker will be identified with a number 1 to 500. All such tokens are hung in a serial order on a board placed at the factory gate. As the worker arrives, he or she removes the token from the board and puts it in a inbox kept nearby, or hang it on another board which is specially kept for this purpose. Means there are two boards, one is called outboard, other is called inboard. When person leaves, he or she puts this token on the outboard, and when person comes, he picks up the token from the outboard and puts it in the inboard. After the fixed time, the box or the second board is removed. Those coming late have to hand over their token personally at the time office, or so that they can exact time of the arrival can be noted. Means there are two boxes that are being put. One is called outbox, other is called inbox. When a person is coming, he or she is taking the token from the outbox, put it in the inbox. When leaving the organization, the person picks up his token, which is being identified or graved on that token, right, from the inbox and put it on the outbox. And if in the inbox a particular token is missing, it means that person is absent from the job. See, the other method is time recording clocks, right? It's a device, right? So, mechanical method of recording attendance and proves quite useful when the number of workers is fairly large. Each worker is allotted a clock card, means a card is being allotted which bears his identification number, name, department. These cards are kept in a rack in a serial order, right? So, there are usually two racks, an in rack and out rack, like we discussed in the previous method. On arrival, the worker will pick up his card from the out rack, put it in the slot of the clock, means that card is being put in the slot of that clock, press a button and the exact time is printed on the card. After this, the card is put in the in rack. An inspection of the out rack will reveal the absentees, because the person who has entered, all those cards will be the in rack, right? So, if the card is in the out rack, it means the person is absent. So, this is the performa of the clock card, as you are saying, forenoon, afternoon, dip. There is no hard and fast rule. This is a broad performa, as you are seeing on the left hand side, worker's name, department, number, means each worker is being allotted a number, week ending, for which week this clock card is, day from Monday to Saturday. So, in the forenoon, in the morning time, in time, out time, afternoon, in time, out time, overtime, in, out, means how many number of extra workers, extra hours which he or she has put, total hours, right? So, is being checked by the timekeeper, the wage rate is being recorded by the cost accounting department, right? Less deductions, so net payable in a week, total wages, right? So, this lower part of the clock card will be maintained by will be recorded by the cost accounting department. So this is a broad performa. There is no out, just what I am showing here is that in this way a clock card can be maintained with the total number of hours which the worker has put in is being recorded. So nowadays this clock card method and all these methods are not being much in being used, right? Nowadays by and large in most of the organization biometric time recording system is being used or biometric time recording clock is being used. So new generation technique which is fast replacing the old type of time recording clocks. Biometric time recording clock is an electronics device to record attendance of the workers. Means in this biometric clock the attendance of the worker is being recorded. There are many types of these biometric machines. There are many types of machines. Some identifies through finger the person to a worker through finger, some identifies through face, some identifies through the eyes, means by the retina of the eyes. There is a sensor in that machine which senses the worker's eye or finger or face, right? So there are many types of these biometric machine. Under this, if I am talking of the machine where the finger is being used, under this the worker simply places his or her finger or hand on the fingerprint reading sensor and the attendance is recorded in the machine. Means the moment you put your finger on the machine, your attendance will be recorded. And since as you know that the fingers, each person has different fingers on the fingers, there are the many lines that are there, right? So each worker has separate lines. So through these lines which are there on your finger, on your palm, right, the machine identifies a person, or it may identify through machine, it may identify through your face, right? So there are different types of machine depending on the requirement of the organizations. So the idea is there in the clock card system or in the other systems, I mean there can be chances where proxy can be put. Suppose a person has not come or person is coming late. He or she will tell to his friend, please put my card in the in column, right? So the moment the person has, even if the person has not come, his or her friend will pick up the card of his friend and put the card in the in column, the time will be recorded. But in this system, no proxy is possible. So the advantage of this system is that it eliminates time card and proxies, enables automatic payroll processing, right, ensures accuracy in records, saves time in the payroll calculation. Means these machines will have a system, will have a software where the wages can be calculated automatically, right. So this is basically the methods of recording the time. Now we talk of the time booking. In addition to recording workers' time of arrival and departure, it is necessary to record the particulars of the work done by worker and the time spent on the each job or process. As I said in the beginning when I start talking of the time keeping and time booking, that it is important to record not only the time spent in the factory and the days when the worker is present, but it is also important to record that how many hours the worker has put in on each job or on each process, right? That you record through time booking. So recording of workers' time spent on different jobs is known as time booking. What is the idea of time booking? The objective is to ensure that the time for which a worker is paid is properly utilized. That if a worker is being paid for 8 hours, that time recording is there, that he works for 8 hours, right? He is in the business, he is in the organization for 8 hours. But how many number of hours he has put on the each of the job, that is also very important, so that his time can be properly utilized. He, at any point of time, you can know that how many hours worker has actually put in a particular process or a product, producing a product, or when he is involved in the productive activities. So to ascertain the labor cost of the work done, that is for each of the work which he is or she is doing, that what is the labor cost involved. To provide a basis for apportionment of overheads. When we are talking of the chapter of overhead, at that point of time I will be discussing in detail that overtime, overhead times or overhead can be apportioned or allocated on the base of either the number of hours or on the base of wages. So, when you have the wage of each work, because you know that on each work or in each process or on each unit, how many number of hours a worker has put, so you can easily apportion the overhead involved in it, right. The other can be the other objective of the time recording is to ascertain the idle time so as to control it. As we discussed in length, that idle time must be controlled. So, when you have a not only timekeeping, but you have also time recording, so you can know how many productive hours or how many number hours with the person has put involved in the production, so idle time can be controlled. So, now what are the methods of time booking? One traditional method is called job ticket. In this, a card is prepared for each job and is allotted to the worker who takes up that particular job in which worker enacts the time or starting and finishing the job. That is, a job ticket is being issued to a worker, and whenever the worker works on a particular job, he makes the recording in that job ticket. After finishing the allotted job, the worker submits the work done along with a job ticket, right. So, this job card or job ticket, whatever we call it, right, records the time spent on a particular job. Only one job ticket is issued to a worker at a time, right. Means if when you are at a particular job, right, you fill up the entries on the job ticket. So, this is a broad performer. Again, I am saying depending on the need of the organization, the job ticket can be changed. So, but broadly these are the different aspects, these are the issues which are being involved, which are being recorded in the job ticket or card, like worker's name, worker's number, department, job number. Each job is being allotted a number, date, I mean on which date he has worked, right, machine number, operation number, time allowed, standard time, time finished, hours taken. For each of the job, there is a standard time, means in that much number of hours, the worker is expected to complete that job. So, time allowed or standard time, we call it. When the worker has started the work on this job, time finished, hours taken. So, job description, hours, rate, amount, right. This hours, rate and amount will be filled by the costing department. So, then it is being countersigned by the workmen, cost clerks, foremen and all these things. So, this is a broad perform of job card. Right. So, each worker will be issued a job ticket or a card, and when he or she works on that job or a particular process, he or he will record the time in devoted on that job. So, this is a combined perform of time and job card. As I said, there are two aspects, timekeeping and time means time devoted on a particular in a organization and time recorded on a particular job. So, time and job card. So, again is a broad performa, name of the worker, department, number, right, what is the number of the job, each job is being allotted a number or each worker is being allotted a number, it may be a number of worker also. So, name of the worker, number of the worker, department, week ending, again from weekly basis, if we presume it is being prepared on a weekly basis, it may be prepared on a monthly basis also, then we will take 4 week or 5 week depending on in a month how many weeks are there, right. So, Monday to Saturday, job number, clock time, in time, out time, job time, start, finish, ordinary time, overtime, job time, idle time, all these are, and it is being countersigned by the inspector, foreman and the accounts clerk, means where the wage is being recorded. So, this is a combined perform of time and job card. So, what we do is that apart from these cards, we also prepared daily time sheet. What we do in this daily time sheet? In this, each worker is issued a time sheet on daily basis to record the time spent on each job during the day, right. So, apart from the job card, you are also being allotted a daily time sheet. The given sheet must be completed on the same day and handed over to the foreman for the signature. Means during the working hours, how much time you have spent, right, on work, this being recorded in the daily time sheet. Major drawback of this system is that lot of paperwork and considerable amount of time in preparation and considering the recorded data for ascertaining the labor cost. This drawback means workers still in India, many workers are illiterate. So, because of that, they are not able to fill it properly if the workers are illiterate, especially at the factory level, right. So, this is a broad perform of daily timesheet. Again, worker's name, number, worker's name, date, department, right. So, work order number, each order is being allotted a number, work order number, details of the work done, time from to. So, total hours, ordinary hours, overtime means if he is working or she is working beyond ordinary number of hours, right. So, what rate the work person is being paid, amount, ordinary amount means normal wage rate and overtime wages. Work means countersigned by the foreman and cross clerk, and the workman will sign. So, this is a broad perform of daily shift. Again, I am telling you time and again that these performers may change these depending on the requirement of the organization. But these are the broader issues which are being recorded in the daily timesheet. Apart from this daily timesheet, there can be weekly timesheet also. Means instead of on a day-to-day basis, it may be prepared on a weekly basis. So, it is similar to daily timesheet with the difference that instead of recording work done on daily basis, it records on weekly basis, thus needing less paperwork. So, what you require is, as I discussed just now in the daily timesheet, the worker has to record it on a daily before leaving the factory, before leaving the organization, the person will fill it and countersign by the foreman. But instead of on a daily basis, it can be prepared on a weekly basis also. So, but by and large, the information recorded is same. It is suitable when jobs are big and the number is small. Means that if a worker spends more number of working hours on a particular job itself, right? So, number of jobs are small, but the working hours which he put in are large on a particular job. So, building and construction work, interior decoration, etc., weekly timesheet can be used. So, this is a performa of the weekly timesheet. Again, worker's name, worker's number, week ending, departments, job number, detail of the work done, right, and then days of the week. It may be prepared in if there may be a very organization where the monthly timesheet can be prepared. So, it will be divided week wise. So, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all days of week, right. So, ordinary hours, overtime, rate and amount. What you notice here is that it is similar to exactly same that of the daily timesheet. The only difference which you find is that instead of one day, it is for a week time. So, this weekly sheets records the time spent on the each of the job or different jobs which a workers put in. So, this way you record the time of the worker. So, what we find is that there are two important things. One is called the time booking and other is called time keeping. Means basically in time booking, we record the total time spent in the factory, and in the time booking, we record the time spent on a particular process or work. Apart from this, in some organization, the workers are being paid instead of hourly basis, workers are also being paid on piece basis, that is called piece work card. So, this piece work card is allotted to each worker and paid where the payment is being made, thus remuneration, honorarium or wages is being paid on a per piece basis, right. So, may be made either for individual job or for recording work done on special jobs. So, this is the performa of the piece work card. Workers number, workers name, week ending, department. I am presuming here that each piece work card is being allotted for a particular week. So, job number, job description of the job, hours taken. Means hours taken are not that much important because basically here the worker is being paid on the base of units produced, right. So, units produced, units rejected, units passed, he may be paid on the base of unit passed, inspected by, right. So, the rate per piece, amount and the total wages, and it will be countersigned by the foreman inspection. So, this way you record the piece card, you record the number of pieces which is being produced by the worker. So, this is basically friends time booking and time recording of the worker. So, these are the broad aspects which we deal in the labor chapter of the cost accounting. That is how you record labor cost in the cost accounting. The basic idea of this labor recording, time recording is, and record means basically we prepare, the payroll department will prepare the remuneration that is being paid to the each of the worker, right, in a month or in a week, and we have a proper record of the wages or the salary that is to be paid to the each of the worker, their time spent, number of days spent, so that proper their bonuses, their salaries and all these can be properly recorded. And the whole idea of the cost accounting is cost ascertainment, cost reduction and cost control. Thank you very much, friends. This is for today.